this is the point where we're going to jump around a little bit. So we're going to do chapter 4, then chapter 7. There are a couple of reasons. I mean, one is that it balances the tests better, which is true. But the other thing is that chapter 7 is all about quadratic equations. And so it fits together really well what we're doing at the end of chapter 4, right? I mean, to go from 4.8 to this, basically you end up going from quadratic equations where you can factor to quadratic equations where you can't factor, right? That would be the next logical step, because certainly you could have a quadratic polynomial that doesn't factor nicely. We just haven't had a lot of that yet, right? Or it'll come up once in a while and we say that they're prime and we just don't do anything else. Now we're going to do extra stuff. The one drawback, although this isn't too bad, is that we just have to go over a couple of things first that if we did things in the book order would have shown up already. One of them is the idea of imaginary numbers and complex numbers, which is actually right before chapter 7. It's in section 6.8. So just the idea of when you have imaginary numbers, it's all kind of based on the idea of being able to take the square root of negative 1. So then the square root of negative 1 would be either I or negative I, right? And I guess the definition is usually the other way, that I is the imaginary number where when you square it, you would get negative 1. So then what we're going to have to do is stuff that looks more like this, because we're going to end up with things where we have like an x squared on one side and a negative number on the other. So something like that, where like if x squared is negative 1, then x is going to be positive or negative I, right? Because I squared is negative 1, but then negative I squared would be the same thing as negative 1 squared times I squared, so that's also going to be negative 1. And we're going to end up with things like this a whole lot, where we have an x squared on one side, some negative number on the other, and so then what you can do is you can basically just you end up being able to factor the I out, basically, and that's the easiest way to handle it. So that's what we're going to do. And we will get full-fledged complex numbers where we have the real part and the imaginary part, right? So the A is just some real number, and then so is the B, but since it's multiplied by I, that would be an imaginary component there. So if we end up with something like this, which will happen within the next 15 minutes for sure, then what you would end up with is a full-fledged complex number, right? You end up there. And that's okay, right? That's going to happen. And it's, I mean, I think if you understand the idea of I, right, that I is the square root of negative 1, then having some real number tacked onto the front before the plus minus doesn't really make things any crazier. The other thing that we're going to have to do is simplify roots. So I'm just going to kind of squeeze it up here. So if you remember this idea, and this is, I guess, going back a little bit, where we had like the exponent laws, where if you had a to the n times b to the n, you could write that as ab to the n. And usually we're doing it in that direction. That's actually true the other way as well, right? I mean, it's an equality. You could go right to left. But if you have a square root, that's technically an exponent. It's the exponent of 1/2. So like if you had the square root of a times b, you could write this as a square root of a times the square root of b. Right? Which really, this is just that law of exponents. It looks different because it's got the radicals in there, but a square root is just an exponent of 1/2. So this thing, it's like the one up on top going right to left, just with a specific n, right? It's where n is 1/2. But how does this actually show up? It'll show up with things like this. If we had to take the square root of 90 and to simplify that, the way that you simplify it is you try to rewrite it to where 90 is the product of a perfect square with something else. So then you kind of run through the perfect squares and you go, oh, which, you know, like 1, 4, 9, 16, 25, like, you know, numbers that are perfect squares. Are any of those going to be factors in 90? Yeah, 9, right? So you could write this as 9 times 10. So then that would be the square root of 9 times the square root of 10. But the square root of 9 is 3. So you could write the square root of 90 as 3 radical 10. So those sort of simplifications also show up in here. And that's another thing that's really in chapter 6. And we need it here a little bit. And I knew that these things were going to happen, that if we did things out of order, that imaginary numbers and then simplifying radicals, we have to do a little bit of it. But for what we're going to do, we're not going to have anything too weird with the complex numbers. It's just that occasionally you got to take the square root of a negative, so you end up with an I in it. And then if you have to simplify a radical, for what we're doing right now, I mean, for quadratic equations, you really just have to worry about square roots. So you just take what's under the radical, see if you can rewrite it as a product where one of the components of that product is a perfect square. And then if you can, you can simplify it a little bit. All right, so first things first, speaking of square roots, even though it says that this section is about completing the square, we got to work our way up to that. So the first thing is if you can use the square root property. So if you have an equation that looks like that, which if you look at number one and number two, they both do, right? You got an x squared on one side, you got a number on the other. Then x would be either the positive or negative square root of p. So you say, okay, well, for x squared equals 49, I'm getting ahead of myself. Right? You could do it here, right? And you could say, well, then x would be equal to plus or minus square root of 49. The square root of 49 is 7. So you could say, well, then x is plus or minus 7, and you're done. And you could do this one the old way, right? Because you could say, well, we could rewrite that with the 0 on the right side as x squared minus 49 equals 0. So this is doing it like it's section 4.8, right? Where then you got the 0 on one side, difference of two squares on the left, so you could factor that as x plus 7 times x minus 7. And then you'd end up saying, well, then x plus 7 equals 0, so x equals negative 7, or x minus 7 equals 0, so x equals 7, right? So then you get the same thing either way. And the first way with the square root property looked a little faster, ultimately. When it's set up in that exact format, right, where you got the number on the opposite side, then that usually does end up being the quickest thing. But then number two, it's got a negative, right? Like, it's still just some number on the right, but it's a negative number. Well, we'll do what we can, right? We use the square root property, since clearly that's what we're supposed to do in this section. So then x would be plus or minus the square root of negative 144. Okay. Well, when you get the negative underneath the radical, and if I scroll up for a second, remember that you can do this. I use a different color, that you can do this sort of thing. Hey, I changed that to red. That's not fair. All right. It's red now. You can do this sort of thing, right? So what I'm going to do down here is that I'm going to rewrite the square root of negative 144 as a square root of 144 times the square root of negative 1, right? I mean, negative 144 is 144 times negative 1, so that's okay. But then the square root of negative 1, that's I. And then the square root of 144 is 12. So then we could say, well, then x is plus or minus 12i. And that's the answer. So that's what you do when you get the negative square root. You just pull that square root of negative 1 out and go, there's an I. And then you deal with the rest of it. Right? So we had a 144. That's a perfect square. It's 12 squared. So that's all we really had to do. Okay. About number three. We're not quite in the right format, but we're close, right? You could add 19 to both sides and you end up with z squared equals 19. But then if you use the square root property, z would be plus or minus radical 19, right? But then that's as far as you can go. That root doesn't simplify because 19 is prime, right? That has no other factors other than 1, right? And that doesn't really help us. But if it has no other factors, it certainly doesn't have any that are a perfect square. So that's the whole thing right there. All right. Then the next one doesn't quite look like it's in the right format, right? We want just the r squared by itself. So let's get rid of that 1/3, right? That's what we usually do anyway when we're solving equations. So we got fractions, get them out of there. So yeah, let's get that 1/3 out of there. So multiply both sides by 3. Oops, that should be a 1 over 3, not a 1 over r. Writing too fast. So 1 third times r squared equals 3 times 12. So r squared is 36, right? Because the 3 times 1 third, that's going to be 1. Oh, this looks like it's doable. Right? Then r is going to be plus or minus the square root of 36. The square root of 36 is 6. Plus or minus 6. All right. Done. How about the next one? Where we've got a 28 over here that we kind of don't want, right? We would rather just have a y squared. So if you subtract 28 from both sides, then what you're going to end up with is that y squared is 13 minus 28, which is negative 15. Okay, we've got a negative, but we can still use the square root property, and we can say that y is plus or minus the square root of negative 15. And just like with that negative 144 earlier, I would just pull the square root of negative 1 out of this thing and say this would be plus or minus the square root of 15 times the square root of negative 1. Because on that square root of negative 1, you go, okay, well, that's I, right? So we'd have plus or minus radical 15 times I. Some people like to put the I in front of the radical. I always put it at the end. It doesn't matter, right? They're multiplied. The I times radical 15 or radical 15 times I, right? That's 6 of one, half dozen of the other, right? Exactly the same thing. And that's the final answer because 15, it has factors, right? Like 3 and 5, but those aren't perfect squares. So you can't simplify that radical at all. All right, number 6. This looks a little more complicated because the thing being squared is not just a p, it's a p plus 2. It's a little bit more complicated, but it's not really that bad because still you've got some quantity being squared. So you can actually use the square root property right now and say that then p plus 2 would have to be equal to plus or minus the square root of negative 6. So it still works the same way, even though the thing being squared is now a binomial. That actually doesn't affect what you do really at all. I guess we got to simplify that radical, pull the negative 1 out. So p plus 2 equals plus or minus radical 6 times radical negative 1. But then the square root of negative 1, just like before, it's I. So plus or minus radical 6i. And you can't simplify the radical 6 any further. Right, its factors are 6's factors are 2 and 3. Those aren't squares. But then we want the p by itself. So if you subtract 2 from both sides, the convention is to put that in the front. So to write it like this. So negative 2 plus or minus radical 6i rather than plus or minus radical 6i minus 2. The reason for that is that if you had to do the plus or minus and write the numbers individually, it's a lot easier with the plus or minus in between. So that's the reason for that move, although that is the accepted convention to do that and to put the I at the end, right? When you have a complex number, you put the real part first and the imaginary part, traditionally, right? So we can stick to that. We don't need to be contrarians and do it in the opposite order. Although I guess you could if you really wanted to. Let's see. Then number 7 is kind of a similar thing where we've got something being squared that's not just an x. And I guess we got to move the 20, right? Because we want the thing being squared by itself. So we'd want 4x minus 3 quantity squared equal to 20, which is what you get if you add 20 to both sides. And then if we use the square root property, we end up with 4x minus 3 equal to plus or minus radical 20. Now, 20 isn't negative, so we're not factoring a negative 1 out. But we are going to do something because one of the factors of 20 is a perfect square, right? Because 20 could be written as 4 times 5, and 4 is a perfect square. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to say we can rewrite that as 4 times 5, but then we could break that up into two radicals. So 4x minus 3 equals plus or minus radical 4 times radical 5. But radical 4 is 2, right? So we could say, well, then 4x minus 3 equals plus plus or minus 2 radical 5. And then we just have to move some stuff around, right? So I guess I can do the rest of it over here. So I'll just rewrite that last line, the 4x minus 3 equals plus or minus 2 radical 5. And then you could add 3 to both sides. And I guess you would put the just that standalone 3 out front. So 4x equals 3 plus or minus 2 radical 5. And then you divide both sides by 4 to get the x by itself, right? So you could say that x was 3 plus or minus 2 radical 5 over 4. Right, that way you've got it all written as one thing. Or if you broke that up into two fractions, the thing I've boxed in already is the way you usually write that. But you could write it like this, and it would also be right if you wrote it as 3/4 plus like 1/2 radical 5. That's correct, although usually you keep it as one big quotient rather than breaking it up. That would be a plus or minus. And you can do this because then if you broke it up into fractions, you have 3/4 plus 2 radical 5 over 4, and that 2/4 would reduce to 1/2. So you could do that if you wanted, but I think most people do it that way. But either one would be technically correct. Okay, next. Finally, we're getting to completing the square. So why did we do all that square root property stuff first? Because basically that's the second half of how to solve an equation by completing the square. You end up in that situation. But how do you actually complete a square? Well, what you're trying to do is you've got something that's not a square, but you want to end up there. So the thing that you're aiming for, like where it says kind of like what we started with in example number 6. So if I go up there, just for a second to point at it, like that p plus 2 quantity squared, that's the thing that you're aiming for. Because then if it looks like this, you can go, oh, square root property, right? And you can go from there. You can basically do what we did in number 6. So if you have one side of this form right here, where you just have the x squared plus some number times x, and you want to turn that into a perfect square, what you're going to end up doing is adding the same thing to both sides so that on the side with the x squared plus bx, you'll get a square. So you divide b by 2 and then square whatever that number is. That'll complete the square. So to say it differently, you'd add b over 2 quantity squared to both sides. Why does that work? And it's easier to see this with examples. I'm well aware of that, and we'll get to one in a second. But the reason it works, if you squared this binomial, the x plus b over 2, you'd have x squared, and then there's the outer product, the b over 2 times x. The inner product's the same thing. And then the last one, you'd have b over 2 times b over 2. So it's b over 2 quantity squared. But those two middle terms, if you add them together, b over 2 plus b over 2 is b. Right? So by adding on the b over 2 quantity squared, if you look at this from right to left, that will give you something that you could write as a binomial squared. So the quantity that's on the right, like it says in this last bullet point, so the thing all the way on the right, which is the trinomial here, right? That's the thing on the right. So you basically, you end up there and you kind of go back to ending up here, right? You end up factoring it and to where you've got a perfect square, and then you use a square root property. So that's why it works in general. But this is much easier to see going through some examples. All right, so first, just completing the square. So the thing that you want to focus on is the number that's multiplied by x. So like here, it's the 8. Number 9, it's the negative 10. 10, it's the 3. 11, the negative 1/2. Those are the things that we're going to need. So like for 8, so half of 8 is 4, right? So there's dividing by 2. Then you want to square the 4. So 4 squared is 16, right? So if we add that in, you'd have x squared plus 8x plus 16, which if you factor that, is going to be x plus 4 times another x plus 4, or x plus 4 quantity squared. Right, so you add the 16 to it, you get the perfect square. And we can do the same sort of thing here with number 9, where then half of the coefficient of y, so half of negative 10, is negative 5. But then we need to square that, so the negative 5 squared is 25. Right, so then that means that what we're going to do is add 25. And so you end up with y squared minus 10y plus 25. But that would be y minus 5 times y minus 5. So it's y minus 5 squared. Another thing to notice, I'm going to do this in a different color to point at it. All right, so half of 8 is 4, right? And then notice here it's x plus 4 quantity squared. Half of negative 10 is negative 5. Y minus 5 quantity squared at the end. That's not an accident. That's always what it is. So the b over 2 is the thing that's part of the binomial, which, I mean, I guess if I scroll up for a second, you can see it in here, right? X plus b over 2 quantity squared on the left side in that first green box. So you can anticipate when you're going to write this as a binomial being squared what the other part of that binomial is going to be. It's half of the number that's multiplied by x, right? It's your degree one term, it's half of its coefficient. That will work every single time. So here, sadly, it's going to be a fraction, but they happen. So, oops, didn't switch. So with this one, it's going to be that half of 3 is, well, 3 halves would be the best thing to do, I think. Keep it as an improper fraction. And then if we square that, so 3 halves squared, you would square the top and square the bottom. So that's going to be 9 fourths. So that means that we're going to add 9 over 4. So what we're going to end up with is z squared plus 3z plus 9 over 4. And this is going to factor as z plus 3 halves squared. And here I'll admit that I'm using it. The idea of it's just going to be b over 2. That's a tough one to see the factorization right away. But 3 halves, 3 halves. Right? So it will work if you multiply it out as well, right? Because you get z squared plus 3 halves z plus another 3 halves z. 3 halves plus 3 halves is 3, right? And then 3 halves times 3 halves to finish out the FOIL would give you the 9 fourths. So yeah, it'll work. And then number 11, we've got a fraction to begin with this time, because that does show up, but half of negative 1/2 is negative 1/4. And then if we square that, negative 1/4 squared is going to be 1/16. So that means that we should add 1/16. And so if we do that, we're going to have a squared minus 1/2 a plus 1/16. And then that will factor into a minus 1/4 quantity squared, right? So once again, I guess I can do the red arrows. Negative 1/4, negative 1/4. All right, so that maneuver is basically the first half of how to solve a polynomial equation by completing the square. And the second half is the square root property. So now we're actually going to go through and do the whole thing. So we got a few of these in here. All right, so what you do generally is if you're going to solve an equation by completing the square, you need the left side to look like what 8, 9, 10, and 11 look like, where you got your degree 2 term, your degree 1 term, but no constant. Then you complete the square by adding the same thing to both sides. Factor, which should just be a perfect square trinomial, so you'll just end up with a binomial squared, and then you can use the square root property. All right, so with something like this, this one's already set up, right? So number one, sometimes you don't have to do it, right? The writing it in the form x squared plus bx, it's already like that because we got the x squared plus 4x. But we need to complete that square. So I'm going to do this kind of off to the side, maybe in a different color. So half of 4 is 2. And then we need to square that. So 2 squared is 4. So that means that what we need to do is add 4 to both sides. And that is what is going to happen over here. So plus 4, plus 4. And we're going to end up with x squared plus 4x plus 4 equals 13. But the thing that's on the left is a perfect square. All right, it's x plus 2 times x plus 2, or just x plus 2 squared. And at this point, we could use the square root property. And then we could say, well, then x plus 2 would be equal to plus or minus radical 13. And then if you subtract 2 from both sides, then x equals negative 2 plus or minus radical 13. And that's your answer. All right, so we had the format already set up for how to complete the square on the left side this time. And so then we did it, right? Took half of the 4, which is 2, square, you get 4, add the 4 to both sides. We got the perfect square trinomial on the left, which then we can write as a binomial squared. And then from there, it's the square root property, right? So basically, once you get here, you're just using the square root property the rest of the way down, right? So that's the point, is to get it to there, right? That's why you complete the square, so you can get it to where you can use the square root property. Because then that's a thing we already know how to do. Okay, how about something like 13? That's not quite in the format that we want, but we don't have to make much of an adjustment. We just don't need the 1 there. We need that on the other side. So subtract 1 from both sides. And we're going to end up with r squared minus... Why is that an a? That should be an r. So I'll have to fix that. It should be the same variable. 14r. 14r equals negative 1. And then we're going to complete the square on the left side. So if we're going to do that, so... For completing the square, what we're going to have is that half of negative 14 is negative 7. And then if you square negative 7, you're going to get 49. So that means we need to add 49 to both sides. So that's what we're going to do, right? So I guess I'll keep this part brown since it's the completing the square part. And if we do that, then what we're going to be left with is we're going to have an r squared minus 14r plus 49 on the left. And on the right, we're going to have 48, right? So on the left, that's a perfect square, right? That's r minus 7. Quantity squared. And then we got a 48 on the right, so it's time for the square root property. And we're going to have r minus 7 equals plus or minus the square root of 48. And 48 does have a couple of factors that are perfect squares. So you can say, well, 48 is divisible by 4. That's true. It's also divisible by 16, which would be better to just do it all in one shot like that, I think. So we can say that r minus 7 equals plus or minus radical 16 times radical 3, because then radical 16 is 4, right? So we end up with r minus 7 equals plus or minus 4 radical 3, and then you just have to add the 7 to both sides, And you'd end up with that R is equal to 7 plus or minus 4 radical 3. And there's our answer. Okay, not too much different than 12, except for the fact that when we had that radical 48, there was extra stuff that we could do. But we did have to rearrange things a little in the beginning, right? We had to move that 1 so we were in the right format for completing the square. But other than that, not too different. Not as different as 14 is going to be. So to use a little bit of foreshadowing, I suppose. With 14, we need to have it, if I go back up for a second, we got to have it in the form of x squared plus bx. So that means the leading coefficient's got to be a 1, not a 2. All right, because we've got just an x squared and x term here, so we don't have a constant that's already been moved, but we've got to divide both sides by 2 in order to get the coefficient of 1 to the x squared. You have to do that. So the first step here is, so the leading coefficient is not equal to 1. And so since it's 2, we're going to have to divide both sides by 2, or multiply both sides by 1/2, right? Either way, whichever way you want to look at that. What you would end up with would be, let's see, x squared minus 5/2 x equals 1/2, right? That's where we're going to end up. But we got to complete the square, right? So, all right. We got the right format now, right? Because we've got a coefficient of 1 of the x squared, and then we just have the x term. We got the number on the other side. So for completing the square, so let's see, half of negative 5/2 would be negative 5/4, right? I mean, if you multiply by a half, that's where you end up. And then if you square that, negative 5/4 squared, so square the 5, you get 25, square the 4, you get 16. So we're going to get that, and we're going to have to add 25 over 16 to both sides. So, all right, I guess let's go ahead and do it, right? So if we did that, what we would end up with is, I guess I'll just do this line in brown, x squared minus 5/2 x plus 25 over 16 equals 1/2 plus 25 over 16. And the thing that is on the left is a perfect square, because that's going to be x minus 5/4. And making 5 is actually really hard with this pen for some reason. I don't know why. 5/4 there squared. And that's going to be equal to, really, this ends up being 33 over 16, right? Because the 1/2 will be 8 over 16 if you get a common denominator, and then 8 plus 25 will give you that 33. So you'd end up here. And then if you were going to use the square root property, you would get that x minus 5/4 equals plus or minus the square root of 33 over 16. But then, and I guess I'll just keep this all in blue so it stays separate from the completing the square part, that would mean that x minus 5/4 equals plus or minus, you could rewrite that as radical 33 over radical 16. But then radical 16 is 4, right? So you'd say, well, then x minus 5/4 equals plus or minus radical 33 over 4. And then if you add 5/4 to both sides, you get that X was 5/4 plus or minus radical 33 over 4. Or, if you would prefer this written just as one big expression, 5 plus or minus radical 33 all over 4. Right, you got a common denominator, so you could combine those if you wanted. And that's where you would end up. Okay, so with this one, the big thing is that the leading coefficient wasn't 1 to start out with. So we had to make it so. So the leading coefficient to start out with was a 2. Divide both sides by 2 to start out with, you end up here. That meant that we needed a weird number to add in to complete the square, because we have a fraction that's the coefficient of x, but you square that fraction. Well, I guess take half of that fraction and you square it. You get 25 over 16, add that to both sides. We had to add fractions there by getting a common denominator, but at least we had a 16 on the bottom, so then we could say, oh, well, we get that square root, the square root of 16 is 4, so then at least the simplification actually worked out kind of nicely at the end. But this one's kind of involved, right? There's a lot happening here, and I think 15 is also going to be sort of involved. So the first thing that you would probably think with 15 is that 16's got to be on the other side if we're going to complete the square, right? We need the x squared term and the x term together, but not that constant. Okay, fine. We can rewrite this as 3x squared plus 12x equals negative 16, right? Just subtract 16 from both sides. But then just like before, like with number 14, the leading coefficient's not 1. You got to make it 1. So I guess I'll write this one in as multiplying both sides by 1/3 to do that. So 1/3 times 3x squared plus 12x equals 1/3 times negative 16. So let's see, the left side, this actually works out pretty well. It's just x squared plus 4x. And then the right side is negative 16/3. And there's no point in rewriting that at all. Just leave it alone for now. Completing the square is not bad this time, and the reason it's not bad, the coefficient of x is even. Right? Those are the best, right? Because then you take half of an even number and it's still an integer. If you take half of an odd number, it's not. That's where you got fractions. So when it's an even, that's the best. So for completing the square, so half of 4 is 2, but then 2 squared equals 4, right? So you take half of that 4, that coefficient, and square it, you get another 4. So that means we're going to add 4 to both sides, right? So we end up with x squared plus 4x plus 4 equals negative 16/3. Plus 4. All right. Well, then that's a perfect square on the left, and it's actually one that's come up before. That's just going to be x plus 2 quantity squared. And then on the right, you need to get the common denominator again, but if you do that, you would basically just multiply 4 by 3 over 3, and you'd end up here. So then you can add those together after you rewrite the 4 as 12/3. And we could have x plus 2 quantity squared equals negative 4/3. And then we could use the square root property, where we'd end up with that x plus 2 is equal to plus or minus the square root of negative 4/3. But then, just like before, you're taking the square root of a negative, rewrite it so it's a product where you have a square root of negative 1. So that way you take care of your I. Right, so x plus 2 equals plus or minus square root of 4/3 times the square root of negative 1. So that's an I. But you could also rewrite the square root of 4/3 as a square root of 4 over the square root of 3. So I'm going to do both of those things in the step. So I'm going to rewrite this radical here as the square root of 4 over the square root of 3. And then that's going to be times I, since that's what the square root of negative 1 is. All right, but the square root of 4 is 2. So you end up with x plus 2 equals plus or minus 2 over radical 3i. And then you could say, well, then you could just subtract 2 from both sides and you get that x is equal to negative 2 plus or minus 2 over radical 3 I. Now, I would consider that to be done, but our book, and therefore the homework, likes it if you rationalize the denominator. So it doesn't like radicals in the denominator. So I guess let me write this in a different color, not orange, red. There. So if you needed to rationalize the denominator, the easiest way to do it is going to be like this. So I'm going to write most of this in blue, and I'm just going to put the rationalization part in red. So you'd have that x was negative 2 plus or minus 2 over radical 3, here's the red part, times radical 3 over 3, over radical 3. I. So multiplying by radical 3 over radical 3 doesn't change the expression, right? Because radical 3 over radical 3 is 1. But then if you're multiplying across, what'll happen where I have that red stuff is that you're going to get 2 radical 3 over 3 times I. So that's what it would look like with the rationalized denominator right there. Right, because the square root of 3 times the square root of 3 would have to give you 3, by definition, right? That's how square roots work. When you square them, you have to get that number. So you square radical 3, you get 3. So our homework likes the answer like that. Like, as far as I'm concerned, like, if it was just like a traditional handwritten test and somebody did everything and left it like this without the rationalized denominator, I wouldn't actually care, to be perfectly honest. If you can get to this point, like this first thing that I got boxed in, you know what you're doing, right? For sure. But to rationalize the denominator, it's just the part that has that radical on the bottom, you just multiply the top and bottom by the same radical, and that takes care of it. And you just multiply left to right with the numerators and denominators, and that'll give you the rationalized denominator. So rationalized just means no radicals, right? So you have an integer, a rational number instead of a radical, which would be an irrational number. So, all right, that takes care of number 15, and that takes care of section 7.1. So there's a lot in here, and it's basically two big pieces, because you have the way that you complete the square, and then you have the square root property, and then the way to solve a quadratic equation by completing the square is basically combining those things together, right? Where you complete the square first, then the square root property, and then you'll get your answer. And sometimes the answers can be kind of crazy looking if you end up with things that, you know, aren't perfect squares and you're taking the square root of them. But I guess it just sort of comes with the territory, right? Most numbers aren't perfect squares. So that is just a thing that's going to crop up a lot.